We are joined here by India's latest grandmaster, Karthik Venkatraman. Karthik, first of all, congratulations on becoming the 55th GM. I haven't wished you personally, so great job.
Thank you.
How was that day when you became a GM? How was the feeling?
I was relieved because for continuously 7 or 8 tournaments, I had this thing to make a norm, like to complete the GM title and then to like achieve the safety point or something. So those 8 tournaments I played quite badly. So I didn't play well. So after achieving the GM norm, I was very relieved.
And who are some of the people whom you would like to thank for your GM title?
My parents and my coaches and friends.
Who are the coaches?
Okay, from starting, like when I started chess, I started training with Navin sir and Shiva Kesul from my town, and later Ramakrishna sir from like he helped me.
J. Ramakrishna, yeah.
No, it's Polavarpur Ramakrishna.
Yes, right.
So he helped me. I got to 1900 from 1600 with the help of him. And later, okay, there were some coaches, but then I started training with Manikanda Swami and his assistant Hari Aran. So that helped me cross 2300. And later, I trained with Goloshyapo. It didn't work out well, but maybe now it's like paying off.
Maybe all the knowledge was already there and now you started applying it.
Yeah. And also friends like Ravi Teja, C.R.G. Krishna, and all like Andhra people, there are a few people who are very helpful during the tournaments. So I would like to thank them.
Wonderful. And you know, Anand, when he became a GM, he said that for a few months he felt as if he had no aim in life or in his tournaments, because earlier he had to go to a tournament and score a norm always.
Yes.
But now that you have achieved it, do you also feel the same or it's different?
It's different for me. Like I want to like increase my rating, and there are goals for me. Okay, initially like for 1 week or so it was the same, but again I'm playing tournaments continuously, so new aims come.
So what's the new aim?
Like for now, I'd like to maybe touch 2600 and later maybe 2700.
And you are right now playing at the World Junior Championship in Turkey. You just beat one of the most talented players in the world right now, Haik Martirosyan. Did you know about him before?
No, I did not know about him. I came to know about him in this tournament only.
He played in this match of millennials for the world versus USA. So a very strong player, and today when you played with him with the white pieces, instead of your usual Rai Lopez, you went for the Italian game.
Yeah, the boring Italian.
but how did you get the confidence to try out something new against a strong opponent?
I prepared this. He played d3. He usually plays castles after that. Like I was preparing this bishop g5 line, which is interesting. I looked at a new book by Alexander Delcho.
Yes.
Bishop c4 in the open games.
So. I met him a month ago in Bulgaria, and he said the book is very good.
Yeah.
Do you also think
it's
the same?
Very good. It will be good enough maybe for 1 or 2 years, I guess.
Okay.
And then it will be outdated again. So I thought he will play this, but he played h6 and avoided the bishop g5 variation, and I had to settle for this normal Italian. But later, in the middle game, he didn't play very well. I don't know, I played d4 at one moment. Maybe he could have taken on e4 and maybe it's just equal. I'm not sure, but maybe it's just
so how does that variation go? After you play d4?
d4, okay, I was not considering knight e4. Like, when I started, like, after I played, I was looking at this knight e4, knight e4, d5, maybe bishop into d5, queen d5, d into e5. I was not sure, like, I thought it would be good enough, maybe queen d1, rook d1, rook e8 or something. Okay, still I'm not sure, but maybe it equalizes. But okay, he played e d4 and within 3-4 moves I got into a better position, playing against isolated pawn.
Yes.
So, and slowly, okay, the queens got exchanged and...
When you had two rooks and a knight and this isolated pawn, what was your strategy like? How to make progress in that position?
Okay, I had to be quick to win the d5 pawn. Like, if I had played normally, maybe you would bring the king quickly and maybe f6, king f7. Maybe if the king comes to e6 or something to e file, it would be difficult, I think. Maybe like later I had to construct new plan and all. But this was straightforward actually. Rook d3, I'd play. After rook d3, my plan is simple, knight e3 and maybe c4 at some point. Maybe like he could have tried knight f4 or something. I'll play rook d2 and there was this d4 chance. But then knight c2, d3, knight e1, it was complicated, but I think I'm winning the pawn anyway. So it was forcing, so it was easy for me to play.
But when you got knight c4 and knight into b6 and then you won a pawn because you won the d5 pawn, were you confused whether to go into the rook endgame or to preserve the knight?
I was sure to play preserve the knight, but I didn't know how to preserve it properly. Like, there were many moves at that point, knight c7, knight f4. I was not sure where to place the knight. The rook endgame, okay, I have drawn many games like this, like going into the rook endgame. So I was a bit careful preserving the knights.
Right, so you preserved the knight and then you had this strong a pawn, and this pawn cost him an exchange. So you were rook versus knight.
Yes.
Was that endgame easy to win or it was not so easy?
It was not, I thought it was a simple win, but apparently I didn't find a straightforward win. Like, I had to rely on my opponent's time pressure to like trick him into one position.
So what did you strategize? Because you had these pawns on g4 and f4 against f7 and h6. So how to make progress there?
I'm not sure, maybe like there is one idea with keeping the rook on a6 and going with the king to h5, but then black can play like knight e4 and there is this knight g3 check always, or you can go back to f6, which I think is difficult. I think it's like there is no more improvement. So like I bought the rook to g1 and I was threatening to play g5 at some point. And okay, I brought my king to the center and I got king f5, and then at the right moment I played g5, but I'm not sure if it's a win now. Maybe at engine table basis would show a win.
Yes.
Or maybe some endgame book. Maybe Mark Dowitzky's endgame manual.
The position of 8 pieces, right? I think it's still not a table base. I think 7 only. So you will have to always exchange one pawn and then check. But it's possible to know from there. Okay. So, but you were able to beat him. That's a wonderful achievement. You are on 4 points out of 5.
Yes.
2 draws. Is this your first time at World Juniors?
I played one in Bhuvaneshwar actually.
Okay.
It didn't go that well, but okay, fine.
How do you feel the strength of this tournament is?
It's very strong. All the players are very young, so you need to be like you need to be energetic and to play here, and also it's very tiring.
So rest day tomorrow will help.
Yeah.
And how do you find the organization of the event?
It's very, the tournament hall is very good, but the accommodation is little far from the official hotel, so, but the rooms are very good, so it's fine.
Okay, and Karthik, what do you say is your biggest strength as a player that helps you, you know, you become a GM right now?
I'm not sure actually, like, currently, okay, I'm just playing chess and, okay, if I get some attacking position, I try to attack, and if I get some positional, I try to play positionally. I'm not sure, maybe you have to tell.
But one thing you told me a few minutes ago is that your endgame knowledge is not as great as it should be for a grandmaster.
Yes.
So, people say that you should know endgames really well in order to be a strong player or a GM. But you are here, your endgame knowledge is not so much, but yet you are a GM. How do you explain that?
Okay, you should try to be different from others. In that way, okay, I'm little different. I play fast, and okay, I never focus that much on endgames because it is totally boring. So, but okay, when you are going much higher, like you need to focus on endgames, and you can make decisions quickly.
So right now you play, you calculate and you play endgames. But you mean to say if you know the knowledge, you don't have to calculate. You can just assess it with your knowledge.
Yeah, without endgame knowledge, you cannot assess properly. Like today, like I didn't. I was trying, but maybe it's a draw. Like I don't know. Like if you know the assessment, like you can play confidently. While defending, it would be much better. And also against Karthik Murli, like I thought I'm lost. So okay, I didn't play that confidently. If I had known that it's a draw position or something, like I would have played confidently. So, and yeah, so it's better to know.
So you have a clear path to improvement now to study endgames.
Yeah.
Well, Karthik, all the best and take good rest on the rest day, and good luck for the second half.
Thank you very much.